friend and colleague of Miss Price, sat with her to talk, not about operas and concerts, but about background and family. What truly makes her Leontine Price.
Terrific. I want to ask you with a little bit of a prelude to it.
Yes?
Last December, my wife and I were in Washington, and we found ourselves at the occasion of the Kennedy Center Honors.
Yes.
And we were at the dinner, and she was sitting next to Brigadier General George Price.
Oh.
And I suddenly realized that Brigadier General Price was your brother. It occurred to me that here is an extraordinary brother and sister combination. And here are the two of you on the top pinnacle of your individual choices. Now, there has to be a fantastic story to that. You must have had some very special parents. You must have had all kinds of the things that I believe are still vibrant in America. Energy, talent, which comes from the Lord, but talent and energy and drive and intelligence. And I wonder if you would like to comment on that a little bit, because it's really an extraordinary story.
I'm very proud to say that the answer to all those questions are, in substance, two names, Catherine Baker Price and James Anthony Price. Our very extraordinary parents. I think that sometimes when I see my brother, when we're together, there are certain areas of my father that are so totally fantastic in him, as in my mother seems to be for him. Apropos to egos, I adore my brother. He is very elegant, beautiful, definitely the brains in the family. It's more than a pop. Possible. I try to keep him under wraps because he'll totally block me out. He's really extraordinary, gentlemen. I guess we, in a sense, inherited all of the things that I think are still very, very essential to doing anything well, even now, which I tell the youngsters who ask me this question, and that is burning the midnight oil, the desire to be the best you possibly can be, to work very hard at it, to be inspired by your own belief in yourself, to an extraordinary family ambiance of love and discipline, which is a wonderful combination.
Absolutely.
The religious background. Actually, the difficulties, I think, for us both, as we say often, began later. But not early in Mississippi. It's an extraordinary thing. That's a strange thing to say.
Yes,
very,
it is.
Very incongruous. But I mean that. I think that there are times now that both of us believe that our roots and our childhood were so wonderful and so untampered with for a development of youngsters. It was also a community effort. It's that wonderful kind of, some people would call it provincial. There are times now, maybe I would prefer refer to it as that, but basically, they're healthy. I remember one teachers who cooperate with your parents to see that you are, you know, doing the best that you possibly can be. I guess in a sense you'd call us maybe overachievers, but why not? If you overachieve, you're bound to maybe succeed in something, you know. And I am extremely proud of him. I mean, speaking of heroes, he is my number one hero.
I can understand
besides
that.
My father. Absolutely.
No, I can understand that.
It's two egos that don't need to be collected and offered, you know. I mean, I actually am definitely my brother's sister. It's not the other way around when we are together.
As a matter of fact, he did make that rather clear.
Yes, he does. It doesn't take long.
He isn't shy about it. There's no problem about that.
No.
But your father and mother, in terms of their lives in Mississippi, both of them obviously must have been people of determination, of unusual interest, of love of family.
I think it's the loving parents and their inspiration and what they give to you, along with the ambiance of the community as well. But I would singularly give credit to my very beloved, wonderful mother and father.
Is your father the one that was involved in church work?
Well, they were both very great contributors to their community. My mother's a whole kitchen was like the lighthouse. She was a beaconing light. I don't know to this date how she did everything that she did in a given day. I go to Europe and to Ponce, East and West, all over the world, and I meet someone that my mother delivered as the most successful Jones County midwife. Also, I think she overdid naming too many people Leontine, but then maybe she was a little weary at the time. My father was not a very educated man in the technical sense of the word. My mother actually graduated from a college very close to my heart, to which and on whose campus I have to build a library, which fortunately is named for me, because it was my mother's alma mater. It's Rust College in Holly Springs, Mississippi, one of the first educational institutions for freshly freed slaves. And she was a student there. My father, I think, probably finished the sixth or seventh grade, but he was so extraordinary. He was sort of the local electrician and carpenter. He could build anything and he could repair anything. He could take any electrical item apart and put it together again. Extraordinary brain. It was, if he had not been, I'm sure, so poor and the things had not been so difficult in his childhood, he probably would have been, you know, would have been able to accelerate on that skill. But he was certainly very useful to the community in many ways. They were, and my mother, of course, was a bulwark of strength in the church. And everyone told her their problems. It was, our house was like a maybe it's why I sort of scream for my privacy now, because our house was like open sesame to everyone in the community. It was extraordinary.
But I have noticed over the years that you do like your privacy, and now I think I'm beginning to understand the real motivation for it. Because if your house was an open sesame,
it really was for the entire community. All problems were solved by my mother or my father, or collectively or singularly. It was extraordinary. I would say that's only a part of it. After being involved and seeing that there might be some direction for me to take with a serious musical career, particularly one as extraordinarily grandiose as opera, which I really never would have believed would have happened to me in Mississippi, I promise you. There are days even now I'm not quite so sure how it happened. But I can only do one thing well at a time, and I know myself very well. And when it is time to work, I'm an all work or all play girl. So if it's time to work, I wouldn't say isolate. I am so bent, and I don't want to sound like some kind of a musical Joan of Arc, but why not? If it produces results, it's my way. It's my own pace and my own way of doing the very best consistent performances that I can. And that is absolutely to do nothing else. I don't like the idea of at 8 o'clock or a matinee, any time the curtain goes up, that I have contributed anything that does not make me give the most, the nearest to the best performance that I can give. I have this terrible thing about, you know, doing, because I like to do my best, and why not? And if that's the method that it takes, fine. But then once I am on vacation, I certainly won't accept one single date or do anything except to have a lovely time, go to the theater, see friends, sit in the draft, in air conditioning, you know, the whole thing. And that's really the main reason for it. It cuts down on canceling, which managers like a lot. It cuts down on not being sort of prepared, which conductors like a lot. So it's good for your image, in my opinion, to just take your own pace for doing what you. I just simply cannot socialize an awful lot and sing well, because I have a certain, which my beloved teacher Florence Spate Kimball left me with, and these roots are still, speaking of roots, take me. She said, you know, you just arrested body is arrested voice. A healthy body is a healthy voice.
You discipline your life so that when you're working, you're working. And
yes,
that is a responsibility, and that's a responsibility you keep and you care about.
It's the reward for any element or instant of hard work that you've put in. And it makes you feel terrific. I mean, why would you not want to feel, I like to feel terrific as much as possible. First, to see a delirious joy performing. is something that will always get you out. Now, that means that's involved with the fact that you really, as the kids say in the vernacular, dig your own talent, dig your own voice. Therefore, if you're in love with it and you're sort of crazy about the way it feels to you, you can deliver it with a great deal of happiness, you know. And so all of the things involved in not, you know, it's not a job, in other words, I'm trying to say. It's a pleasure. And then you get down, buckle down to the technical things that it takes to deliver that instrument to the best of your ability and beyond, if possible, and get all the fine points started. It's a very sort of a, it sounds like a distinct regime, but it requires that. It's like a thoroughbred racehorse, you know. You don't find them just wandering around in any stables, or they have a certain kind of brushing down that makes them
What they are.
Exactly. And quality is really better than quantity, I do believe. At least I think so personally. I'd like to try to be magnanimous when I start there too. And as long as the light is on you and you are really warmed very much still by it, and thank goodness in my case, a bit more.
Fine,
thank you. But it's wonderful to be able to say that even while I'm still active, you see, because a very sad thing also is to be a bitter performer who is trying to produce another young artist into you, which is a colossal bore for them and a sad thing for you. To collect enough of the success so that you will be able to pass on, not part of you, but to really, I find that the thing that probably will be very wonderful about this for me is having a non-compromising attitude about my career in this particular way. I have no children. I borrow mine from my brother, you know, But technically, I believe that at this stage, coming another dimension, because I feel I'm on the brink of another dimension in my life, and it's very important to know that you're having those vibrations because you can prepare for it rather than have it meet you head on. And I think that I'll probably be a mother, a sister, and all the things that that Miss Kimball was for me. That's the kind of teacher I'd like to be.
You have come to be, apart from your artistry, a tremendous symbol of what can be done with talent and drive, with joy. A very distinguished and very important person in your own right, and a symbol for your race. I have a feeling that what you have accomplished just by being you has been a tremendous example to lots of people. And I wonder if you have any feelings about that in terms of the next generation coming up.
I kind of express the pride that I have experienced in the progress that has been made just in my field alone in the time that I started. This year's a 30 season career, but an active one that has seen this most grandiose medium of opera extend itself, which actually makes me thrill beyond belief. There are other extensions I'd like to have happen. I'd like to see more black heroes in various parts. That could be due to many circumstances. But the door is there. I'm happy that I had any minuscule part of it, because I always very much liked flexing my muscles, being a pioneer. That really was great inspiration for me. Was a great inspiration for me. Apropos to the word symbol, I do know that I feel this warmth and support of my people. They are able to participate in an appreciation, to come to enjoy cultural events. Now, that is a statement in itself. But to have them be able, because progress has been made in our country and in this ambiance, to come first, to be able to come first, and secondly, to appreciate what is offered. I mean, it just keeps me young and keeps me happy as a lark. And to see really the young ones, you know, really, it's very ego building, and also very inspiring. Very inspiring. Very inspiring indeed.